This is the College of Complexes. I'm Brom Basford. And this is Don Ritchie, who will be our moderator tonight.
All right, our program tonight is the Illinois Campaign for Political Reform. And our speaker tonight is David Melton. He's the executive director of that organization. And he says, I would anticipate covering the history of ICPR, the nature of the issues we focus on, campaign finance, ethics and transparency, and judicial elections all to the state and local level, as well as our views on those issues and what we are doing to promote reform on those issues.
Let's have a warm round of applause for our speaker. Okay, come on down.
Spaghetti
or masticho?
Yes, it does.
Thank you.
No, marinara.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Super sandwich.
What if they didn't have?
Is that
better?
Can you
still hear?
Yes, sir.
What if they didn't have time for Lexington and Concord?
Is that good? Can people hear?
Actually.
Yeah.
Lexington and Concord.
Yeah. Right. Better.
Yes.
This is important stuff.
Oh, David.
All right. Let me thank you all for coming out, and thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here. And I can see we've got a lively group, which I like, because I'm not always such a lively speaker. But I will try. I will give it my best, and then I'm sure we'll get some good rebuttal as well. My name is David Melton. I'm the current executive director for an organization called the Illinois Campaign for Political Reform. And I'm going to share with you three stories tonight, two relatively short and one a little longer and a little more pointed about campaign finance, which will be the final one. But before I start, my wife said I should warn you all that the last time I publicly spoke, I received a note at the end of it from one of the people in the audience. And I was actually quite happy to see that note because it said, if I had only 1 hour to live, I want to spend it listening to you, which I thought was a great note. But when I got home and showed it to my wife, she pointed out to me that I missed that there was an asterisk next to it. And she said, you missed the asterisk. I said, oh, okay. She said, yeah, turn it over. The asterisk on the other side said, because it would seem forever.
Are you ready, Tim?
Yes.
So I hope that's not the case tonight, and I will do my best not to make it the case, but she said I could warn you about that.
It seemed like it was forever.
I passed out a sheet that has some background information about the Illinois Campaign for Political Reform. But the first story I'm going to tell you is basically the story of that organization, so you'll understand what it's all about and where it comes from. The Illinois Campaign for Political Reform was founded between 15 and 20 years ago, depending on when you estimate the start date. It grew out of a commission here in Illinois that was looking at the subject of campaign finance reform. That commission was headed by Paul Simon, former U.S. Senator, and Bill Stratton, a Republican. It was a bipartisan commission. And growing out of that commission, Paul Simon set up a working group. And eventually, he, in conjunction with Bob Custra, who was a Republican lieutenant governor, set up this group and created as the Illinois Campaign for Political Reform in the late 1990s. So we're a bipartisan group. We're interested in political reform in Illinois. Our focus is mostly at the state government level. And we have been around, as I say, then for about roughly 15 to 20 years. And our real founder is Paul Simon. He's the one that the primary one that we look to. And we work with other organizations in the state, like the Paul Simon Institute down in Carbondale and similar good government groups. So you can call ICPR a good government group without defaming us. We won't take it personally. In fact, we'll take it as a compliment. For most of our existence, we had the pleasure to be headed by a woman by the name of Cindy Canary, who some of you may recognize that name. And she was the executive director. And the organization was lucky enough to be funded primarily through a group called the Joyce Foundation. And there was a man there by the name of Larry Hansen who was very interested in democracy projects in the Midwest, and he funded a number of groups, including ICPR. That led to, and so for the first 15 years of its existence, really, ICPR had a relatively easy and somewhat productive history. but starting in 2011, the group encountered some hurdles, some difficulties, as we all do in life. One of the difficulties was that our chief funder, Larry Hansen, at the Joyce Foundation, passed away from brain cancer. As a result, the Joyce Foundation decided it was less interested in some of the things he was doing around democracy in the Midwest, and it turned its attention and its focus and funds to some other things. That has created funding problems for us, as you might imagine. So we've been scrambling for funds for the last few years. Second thing that happened is Cindy Canary, our longtime executive director, there were issues about trying to replace her, so that resulted in additional struggle within the organization, and some additional fumbling around, frankly. And then finally, our longtime board member, Dawn Clark-Netsch, who some of you may recognize as the longtime Democratic candidate for governor and a longtime independent in the Chicago area, passed away about a year ago. And so that was a further blow to our organization. Since then, we've gotten back together, we've regrouped. We have a new leadership team that was basically installed in August of last year. And we're now led by a couple of former state legislators. One is a woman by the name of Susan Garrett, who's a former state senator from the Lake Forest area with a reputation for being fairly independent. And she is independent, I can tell you from personal experience. Second is another woman, another former legislator by the name of Beth Colson. She's a former Republican state representative and also had a reputation for being fairly independent and fair-minded, and she is. We have a couple of other former legislators on our board, both Republican and Democrat. We have former head of the State Board of Elections on our board, and we have some other respected professionals and a wide variety of other individuals. So we are in the process of turning the organization around and giving it a new start, essentially reinvigorating, which is what we've been doing since August of last year.
Hello, my friend.
Here are the issues that ICPR has been focused on throughout its history, and which it remains focused on at this point. I would say they fall into three broad categories. The first category is campaign finance reform. So if any of you remember Paul Simon, you may remember that he was always very interested in the issue of campaign finance reform. He thought that money had a very corrupting influence in politics, and he was looking for ways to try and solve that problem. ICPR, that became one of our primary, if not our primary focus, was trying to find a way to reform this system and diminish the undue influence of money in politics. That remains one of our primary focuses. Over the years, we've had some modest successes, I would say. The most noteworthy was probably that in 2009, in the wake of the Blagojevich scandal, we managed to get Illinois to finally join the rest of the states and finally adopting some campaign finance limits. So we put some limits on the amount that individuals, corporations, and PACs could contribute to each candidate. Basically, those limits were $5,000 per individual, $10,000 per corporation, and $50,000 for a PAC. They were modest, basic limits. They were the kinds of things that were basically enacted 50 years before at the federal level and in most of the other states. Up until that time, Illinois had simply had a system where they said, we just rely on disclosure and the voters can use that information about who gives money to who any way they want. Now, the fact is that for most of that disclosure system's existence, Illinois did not actually make that information publicly available in the sense that it was hidden away in state agencies and it's not easy to get to. We took that information in the early 2000s and we put it into a database called the Sunshine Database. It's available online. And it allows you to look up and see who gave money to candidates, who the top contributors are, things like that, so that you can at least get a picture of who's contributing to state candidates for the state legislature, for statewide offices, and some local candidates. So we've tried to make that information more transparent.
Look it up.
The second big area that we've been interested in is called ethics and transparency. And here we've worked with the legislature over the years in passing repeated efforts to try and improve the ethics and transparency of state government. Now, looking back on George Ryan and Rod Blagojevich, you may think that we haven't had any success. In fact, we have had a little success. We've made some marginal improvements. So we helped get passed a ban on gifts to politicians, known as the Gift Ban Act, that was passed in 1998. We were helpful in getting legislation to pass that. We helped pass the 2003 State Ethics, State Officials and Ethics Act, which imposed ethics, created inspector generals, and basically created a reporting mechanism for problems in state government agencies. And we helped pass the pay-to-play legislation that barred state contractors from being able to make contributions to people who award state contracts. So we've had some effort, some success over the years, but I would say that Illinois remains a little behind where most other states are in terms of fixing some of these problems, and most other states are not in all that great a position to begin with. We also focused on lobbyist disclosure issues because that has a severe impact on what legislators actually do. And we've been pushing for greater disclosure by lobbyists. Most recently, we've put in a bill that would require local government units, like your mayors, your city townships, your school boards, other units of government, to disclose when they use taxpayer dollars to hire a lobbyist to go down and lobby the legislature on their behalf. Most other businesses and so on have to disclose that information publicly, but the local government units got together and got the legislature to exempt them from that requirement, and as a result, it's not easy to find out the extent to which local government units are actually hiring lobbyists using taxpayer-funded dollars. We've done a survey over the past every few years where we send out Freedom of Information Act requests to about 400 local government units in this area and ask them to the extent to which they've been using lobbyists. We then publish a report. We've done that again this year, and we'll have a report coming out sometime in the next 60 days that summarizes the results of that. But suffice it to say that there are lots of lobbyists who are hired by local government units, some of them for substantial sums of money, and the public is entitled to know that since they're paying for it. The third area that we're active in is judicial elections and judicial campaign finances. And the reason we're interested in that is very simple, really. There's no place where the campaign finance system creates bigger problems, I would say, than when you're asking judges to go out and solicit campaign contributions. Obviously, that raises problems. Those judges, what are they going to promise someone who's a contributor? That they'll be fair and even, that they won't be biased in favor of that person if they come before them? This problem has grown nationally as judicial races have gotten more expensive, which has been a national trend. So that at the moment, when we talk about races for appellate courts, especially for state Supreme Courts, you have campaigns where people are spending millions of dollars on these campaigns. We had one here in Illinois, and it was quite controversial. It resulted in a lot of ethical questions on both sides about why people were contributing to those campaigns and whether those contributions had an effect on some actual decisions, including a decision to reverse a judgment against State Farm for about $1.2 billion for misleading its policyholders about the use of replacement parts in auto repairs. So, in our view, the judicial campaign finance system is an ideal place to start running demonstration projects and trying to improve the system. So we have targeted that area, and we have put in proposals in the past for essentially establishing a public funding system for judicial campaigns so judges do not have to and could not go out and solicit campaign contributions. We have also worked on other related issues. For instance, there's an issue about exactly what rules judges should follow in terms of whether they have to excuse themselves when a campaign contributor comes before them as a party to a case before them. There have been conflicting submissions submitted to the Illinois Supreme Court. We submitted one. Some were good, some were bad in our view. After looking at all of them, the Illinois Supreme Court basically decided it wasn't going to do anything at this point and left it up to the individual judges, more or less, to decide for themselves what they thought was appropriate rather than adopting any set rule. At the national level, you may recall that there was a case in front of the Supreme Court where the conflict of interest was so bad, involving contributions from Massey Coal Company to a West Virginia state Supreme Court candidate of millions of dollars, where that judge was then the deciding vote in a case that reversed the judgment against Massey Coal Company. But the Supreme Court said that rose to the level of a constitutional violation of due process and basically sent the case back and required the judge to recuse himself. That is where we are headed in the future in this state and many other states if we don't do something about fixing the system of judicial campaign financing. But the judicial campaign financing system is only the is basically the nose of the camel. It simply is reflective of the larger problems that we need to talk about, and then I'll talk about a little bit here tonight about the overall campaign finance system in this country and the problems that we have and why, what the heart of those problems is and how to go about trying to solve them. The other thing that we're working on in the judicial area is, for those of you who live in Cook County, which I assume is most of you, as you know, we have a system here where every 2 years we have about 70 judges who appear on the ballot with a question saying, do you want to retain this judge? And for the last 25 years, no judge has been knocked off and no contention. So I guess we could either conclude that all the judges are qualified and capable and doing a good job, or that that system for some reason is not working. And I can tell you that in our view, the problem is that system is not working, and we believe it should be reformed. The problem with that system is this. It's too far down the ballot. Voters cannot possibly be expected to educate themselves about who those 70 judges are that appear on the ballot every 2 years. And each, there's actually three sets of them, so it's actually 210 judges in total. Now what happens is, all those judges get together, the 70 judges who are running, they held a joint fundraiser. They raised about $250,000 to $300,000. And they turn over a lump sum to the local Democratic Party, which then distributes that money down to local ward organizations. Those ward organizations, in turn, tell their voters, vote yes on all the judges, and they pass out palm cards to that effect. The net effect of that, and they give a smaller contribution to the Republicans as well. The net effect of this is that the worst judges in the election always get just over 60%, between 60 and 65% of the vote in the last 20 years. They only need 60% to be retained, so everyone gets retained. The best judges end up getting about 78 to 80% of the vote. So what that means, and then the remaining 20% basically are people who vote no on everybody. So essentially 60% of the voters vote yes on everybody, 20% vote no on everybody, 20% look at the websites and the other information that's out there on judges and differentiate their votes. But because you get the 60% voting yes on everybody, it doesn't make a difference if one of the bad judges are not off. So our proposed reform is what's called a judicial performance commission we would like to see. And there have been two demonstration projects of it that we've done over the last two election cycles in conjunction with the Chicago Council of Lawyers and the Chicago Advocacy Fund. This proposed commission would basically rate the judges in ways similar that the bar associations currently rate the judges, and would use some additional statistical techniques and surveys to make it a little better process. And would decide whether that judge gets a passing grade or not. The last two times we've done this in the elections, roughly 90% of the judges get passing grades. Now that doesn't mean they're all doing great. Of that 90, I would say one-third get an exemplary review saying, you're doing a great job, everybody thought you were doing a good job. The other two-thirds get statements that say, you're doing an okay job, but there's room for improvement. And here are the areas that you can improve in. We give them suggestions, and we share those suggestions with their supervising judges. And when we come back to them, when they're up again in 6 years later, we see if they've improved in those areas. The remaining less than 10% of the judges would get a not recommended from that commission under our reform would have to still stand for election. Judges who got a passing grade would not have to stand for election. The effect of this would be to reduce the number of judges on the ballot in Cook County from 70 judges every 2 years down to 4 or 5 or 6 judges on the ballot every 2 years. And you would know that there was a reason that they were on there, that they had gone before a commission who'd been taking a careful and long look at their record, done research, talked to lawyers, talked to litigants, talked to staff people, talked to others, and as a result of that investigation, the two of them should not be retained. So it's a reason that they're on there. We would hope that at that point, we would have success in knocking those people off the ballot. But that's a proposed amendment. We are working with Representative Cassidy in the House, who has proposed a bill like this. Senator Cunningham in the Senate has proposed something similar where he seeks to up the percentage that judges would have to get, but he's willing to work with us on this kind of a commission. Unfortunately, it's gotten lost in the shuffle probably in this election year, and it also raises issues because within the minority communities, there's diversity of opinion about whether this is good or a bad thing. So as a political matter, we probably have to work to build more of a coalition politically to support this before it's likely to go anywhere in the Illinois House. If it does go anywhere in the Illinois House, where it would go would be we'd have to have a constitutional amendment because retention procedures for judges are set forth in the Illinois Constitution. We'd have to have a constitutional amendment. This would be a proposal to put that constitutional amendment on the ballot. And if adopted, it would work the way I described it. So those are the kinds of things we've been working on. Our tactics in pushing these issues are we lobby people, we put in legislative proposals, we talk to legislators, and so on. We do litigation. So at the moment, we're involved in litigation where, for instance, those Illinois campaign finance limits that were passed in 2009, well, there's I would call it a right-wing think tank that has gotten a couple of plaintiffs to file suit challenging the constitutionality of those limits. Their basic complaint is that there are no limits on the legislative political action committees, what the legislative leaders in Springfield can give to other candidates, and therefore, and that they want to have the same ability to give unlimited funds to whoever they choose. They're claiming that's an infringement of their First Amendment rights to give as much money as they want to anyone they want.
No, not now.
Okay.
So far, we have managed to, the Attorney General has managed to defeat those claims in a preliminary injunction hearing on an initial appeal. It's now back in the trial court. I'd say our chances of ultimately prevailing in that suit are looking good. There'll probably be a decision sometime this summer or fall. And after that, it'll go back up on appeal. But it's typical of the kinds of litigation that's going on around the country by right-wing groups pushing the edge of the envelope on trying to say they should be entitled to give as much money as they want to any candidates they want at any time. And there is a case that's going to be coming out from the Supreme Court sometime over the next 3 months, the McConnell case. This case involves aggregate federal limits. The aggregate federal limit is roughly this. It says in any given two-year election cycle, an individual can only give a total of up to $123,000 to all congressional candidates. So it's an aggregate limit. That $123,000 is about two times the median income of a normal family in the United States, so you wouldn't think that that would really pose much of a problem. In fact, there are less than 100 individuals in the country who ever give anything approaching that kind of money to candidates. But nevertheless, the Supreme Court has taken this case, and the betting is that they will strike down that aggregate limit as an unconstitutional restriction on rich people's right to give unlimited money to candidates. So that decision will probably be coming down sometime in the next few months. And we are part of a coalition that will be protesting if it goes the way that we expect it to.
That's the Illinois Supreme Court?
No, that's the U.S. Supreme Court.
U.S. Supreme Court.
Right. The third tactic we use, apart from lobbying and litigation, is basically public education. And there we go out, we conduct public forums, which are generally free and open to the public, that we hold periodically on various issues. We come out and speak to events like this, and we work with a coalition of other reform groups in the city in various formal and informal coalitions to push for things that we all agree would be good ideas. So that's what ICPR does. Our resources, as I mentioned earlier, are relatively limited at this point. I am the part-time executive director, and there's a part-time staff person who works there. Other than that, we rely on volunteer board members. And we have some volunteer interns who work for us who are either students or recent graduates who are working with us on research and also some administrative projects. And the Freedom of Information Act project that I mentioned. All right, so that's the end of the first story. What is ICPR? What does it do? So on. Let me move on to the second story, how I became executive director of ICPR. This will be hopefully a relatively short story. I did not start out as a nonprofit person or an activist in this area. I actually spent most of my career working on big-ticket litigation at big firms, mostly what we call IP cases, intellectual property cases, patent, trademark, trade secret, copyright cases. In 2009, I decided that I had had enough of that work, and I decided to retire and basically devote myself more to my family and to reform issues that I was interested in working on a part-time basis, and also to just reading a lot more and taking a lot more time off. And I started on that course. I was having a pretty good time of it when, in 2013, some people from ICPR approached me. I had previously contributed some money occasionally, helped them with some fundraisers, but I had not been that active with the organization. They asked me to go on the board, which I agreed to do in the spring of 2013. And when I went on the board and got there, we discovered in the summer of 2013 that we were facing something of a financial crisis, and we had to figure out what to do about it. Long story short, we had a number of emergency meetings, and at one of those meetings, people asked for volunteers to come in and help out and try and straighten the ship. And I did not step backward quickly enough, and that is how I ended up as a part-time executive director. Since I've taken over, we have, with the other new leadership members that I mentioned, the former legislators, we've made significant budget reductions, we've changed operations, we've streamlined things, and we started some new public education campaigns, and we tried to reinvigorate the organization, as I mentioned. So, that's the end of the first two stories. Now let me move on to the third story, which is the real reason I came here, and hopefully it will be a little more interesting, and that's this. I'm here to address what I think is a critical issue facing our country, which is the future direction of our campaign finance system. Now, why do I say this is a critical issue? There are lots of important issues facing us that could be deemed more critical: environmental issues, health issues, war issues, so on. And I don't disagree with that. Those are all important issues. But the problem with our campaign finance system is it interferes with our ability to solve those other problems, because it interferes with our ability to govern ourselves by corrupting, essentially, our self-governing mechanism, our own governance. That is the basic problem, and until we solve that initial problem that corrupts and misdirects or diverts the government from its central purpose of solving those key problems, that government is going to have increased difficulty addressing and solving those problems, which is what we count on it for, ultimately. So, I do not see campaign finance as necessarily the most important long-term issue, but I see it as the most pressing issue that we need to solve so that we can move on to those other issues that exist and address them in a meaningful way with a more effective government that is more representative and more responsive to the people of the country as a whole, rather than the small, rich crust at the top. When I say this campaign finance system is corrupting, I do not necessarily mean people like Ron Blagojevich or Randy Duke Cunningham in California who are actually taking bribes and money. What I mean is it's a system which forces politicians to focus a lot of their time and attention on a relatively small number of rich people who can afford to fund campaigns at the level that they need. So it's a system which is poorly set up, which is a corrupting type system. And when I say corruption, what I mean is not necessarily, as I said, people taking money, bribes, that kind of thing. What I mean is it diverts the attention, particularly of members of Congress, from the issues they should be focusing on, and instead makes them more responsive, makes them listen more to those relatively small number of rich people who are funding their campaigns and the concerns of those relatively small number of rich people. That diversion of resources, you can see it in a lot of places, but one of the best places to see it is when we had all kinds of important issues going on last year. What did Congress end up spending a lot of its time on? The fees that banks charged merchants on credit cards. Why? Because that was a concern to banks and rich people. It was not much of a concern to ordinary people. and it was not justifiable for Congress to devote that much of its resources to that issue. But that's what they spent a lot of their time on. That's the kind of corrupt, that's what I mean by corruption. They're focused on the wrong issues. Government is being diverted from focusing on the important issues to focusing on the issues that are important to the few rich contributors who can fund campaigns. The evidence of this I submit is all around us, and I think there's a growing and a fairly large public sentiment about this, in the sense that there's something wrong, that the system is being corrupt. And there are public polls that support this. In 2012, the second most important issue, according to one of the polls that was done during that election year, was corruption in politics, or the corrupting nature of campaign contributions. Yet neither candidate in the presidential election or in any of the major elections actually addressed that issue. Why? Because they had nothing they could say on it. They both were participating in the system. They both had no choice, essentially, but to participate in the system, even though, excuse me, Mitt Romney could have financed the campaign himself if he wanted enough phone money. But neither of them really had a way of addressing it. And that's unfortunate, because it's a critical issue. And we need to address it. That's not to say that I believe in unilateral disarmament. No candidate who's a serious candidate and wants seriously to get elected, whether to do good things or to do bad things when they go to Washington, can afford to ignore the question of money. If they're going to run a campaign, they need money. That's simply a fact of life. There's no way around it in our current society. And as our society grows ever larger and more complex, that's going to get even worse, as it has gotten worse over the last two decades. The problem is that very few of us have the money to contribute to these increasingly expensive campaigns in any meaningful amount. When I say very few of us, you can find facts on this in a very, very good book that I recommend to all of you, called Lesterland, by a man named Lawrence Lessig. He's a professor at Harvard now, he used to be at Stanford. And he's written a couple books on this. Lesterland is available online for $2 or $3, and I don't remember which. And it accompanies basically a TED talk he did on this subject, but it explains the problem in great detail with much support and statistics and many references for other sources of information if you're interested in exploring it further. And that's where I would recommend you go. He's also written a book called Republic Lost, which describes the system in even greater detail. That came out shortly after the Citizens United decision. Let me give you a few statistics on what I say. The problem with this system is it's increasing pricing campaigns out of the reach of not only average voters, but the vast, vast majority of people in this country. So we have a nation of about 300 million people, plus 10 or 20 million more than that. Let's say there are, actually statistics show there are about 150,000 named Lester in this country. And in fact, one of the reasons Lawrence Lessig called his book Lesterland is because he was making this point. The way our election system really works these days is there's a two-tier election. Before you ever run in a general election in November or in a primary election, you have to get elected, or at least get the support of, a significant number of Lesters. If you don't, Lesters, yes. Of that, from that group of 150,000, you have to find some of them, a significant number, to support you. Why? Because they're the only ones who can afford to contribute significant sums to campaigns. And unless you can raise the money to do that, you cannot run an effective campaign. Campaigns cost a lot of money. For Senate, in the last go-around, the winning Senate campaigns cost, on average, $10.5 million by the winning campaign. The losing candidate spent on average $7.7 million. In House races, the average, mind you, there's a lot of that went over this, the average by a winning House candidate is $1.6 million every 2 years. Losing candidates in the House races spent over $775,000 each. And remember, you have to raise that every 2 years. That's a lot of money you have to raise every day. And in fact, what it causes is, when you go to Congress, one of the first things you get from your party is a suggestion about how you should manage your time in Congress. And they recommend, basically, to new congressmen, but they spend 30 to 40% of their time on the phone or in person raising campaign funds. Is 30 or 40% of the time that your congressman spends is spent trying to raise money for the next election? That's simply a fact of life. It's a regrettable fact of life. It's an unfortunate fact of life, but it is a fact of life. So how does this break down? Let me give you a few more statistics about campaign contributors. So in 2010, which was an off-year election, like 2014, the federal limit at that point was that an individual could give up to $2,600 to one candidate. You could give up to $123,000 to spread out over all the congressional candidates if you wanted to. So how many people actually gave money out of our 300 million plus? About one quarter of 1% gave more than $200 to any candidate. That's about 800,000 people out of the 300 million. The number of people who gave the maximum to one candidate, so roughly $2,400 at that election cycle, was about 0.05%. 1/20th of 1% gave the maxed out on any single candidate. People who gave $10,000 or more to more than one federal, to a group of federal candidates, was 0.01%, 1/100th of 1% of people. People who gave $100,000 or more was 0.00024%. That's about 750 people out of 300 million people in this country. Those are the people that the politicians have to pay attention to. They have the significant dollars. People who gave, because 60% of the politicians' funds actually came from a group of about 100 people in the country. And those are people who gave significantly more than 100,000. They compose 0.00032% of the people in this country. About 100 people out of 300 million. Now, it is inevitable in the system that we have that politicians are going to have to pay attention to these very small number of people to get the money they need for their campaigns. Why? Because that's the only way they can raise money for their campaigns. Now, over the years, we tried to limit the influence of special interests in campaigns by putting caps on the amount of money that people give campaigns. You may remember we did this first. We actually did this first during the Progressive era. When we got rid of the way campaigns were financed in the 19th century, in the mid-19th century, was that federal employees who got jobs through federal politicians had part of their salary taken in an assessment. And that assessment went back to the politician or that party. So you got a federal job, you paid a kickback, basically, to the politician or to the party, and that's how campaigns were funded in the 19th century. Toward the end of the 19th century, we created the civil service system to end this kind of patronage practice, although in many states, like Illinois, patronage continued for a much longer period of time.
No.
But not quite as egregious a system as existed in the mid-19th century. In the Progressive era, we also passed, there was a law passed in 1907, Tobin Act, that prohibited corporations from contributing to campaigns. Why? Because that was right after the Gilded Age, and there was a sense that corporations and rich people had concentrated too much of their power. They did not want that expensive into the politicians. Yeah. There were also campaign limits passed after 1925, after the Teapot Dome scandal, when basically oil contractors were caught bribing federal officials who gave out oil leases on federal land. The modern age of campaign finance really began after the Watergate scandal, when you may remember that one of President Nixon's campaign operatives had a campaign with a slush fund in safe, and that he paid money out of that, including the money to the Watergate plumbers. Following that, there were a series of federal and state campaign finance limit laws passed in this country. for the most part, they said two things. When they were originally passed, they set limits on how much anybody could give directly to a candidate and how much they could give overall to candidates. They also set limits originally on how much campaigns and candidates could spend. Okay? Now, shortly after that was passed in the 70s, that went up to the Supreme Court in a case called Buckley versus Vallejo. In that case, the Supreme Court said you cannot restrict the amount that you can tell candidates or campaigns to spend. That is too much of an infringement on their First Amendment rights, and if we allow you to do that, that could create too much of a problem with incumbents protecting themselves against challengers. So you can't impose those kinds of limits. But you can impose limits on the amount that people can give to candidates, because that's less involved, less First Amendment speech, essentially. So those are that's the basic rule that we've been operating under since 1976. And over time, those federal limits worked okay for about a decade. Then there began to develop loopholes because campaigns needed more money. Campaign consultants and lawyers get paid to figure out ways that they can raise more money. They figured out ways to do that in the 80s and 90s when they raised what was called soft money. This is money that would go to the parties or other people who would spend it basically on a campaign on the candidate's behalf, and it wasn't counted against the limits. So the limits became less and less meaningful as time went on. People recognized this problem, and in the early 2000s, in 2002, Russ Feingold and Senator McCain got together and passed the McCain-Feingold Campaign Finance Act, trying to close that loophole, that soft money loophole, which they succeeded in doing. But this time, the changes never really took much effect because campaigns still needed to raise money, and they figured out very quickly ways around it. Essentially like water finding a way to get through a dike. Eventually it will find the lowest spot and some spot that's vulnerable where it can get through. That's what happens with money in campaigns. And it happened very quickly after the McCain Finance Act. And eventually it resulted in what we call today super PACs. Super PACs come in two varieties. They come in the candidate affiliated type, which are subject to some limits. And they come in the super PAC type, which officially do not coordinate with candidates and can therefore spend unlimited amounts of money on exercising their free speech rights. They just have to avoid saying certain magic words about whether they support candidates, and they can't coordinate with a candidate's campaign committee. But they are essentially free to accept unlimited donations and spend unlimited amounts. That loophole has been made worse by an IRS ruling from the 1950s, which tax lawyers discovered, which basically allows super PACs to not only spend unlimited amounts, but to hide the identities of their donors. The way they do this is through a provision in the tax code. It's called a 501c4 tax corporation rather than 501c3, which is a normal charitable organization. The 501c4s do not have to, as long as they spend up to 50% of their time on social activities, they do not have to disclose the names of their donors, and they can engage, I think, 50% of their time on political activities. It's an historical anomaly that I could go into. There were good reasons why the Supreme Court created that rule in the 50s, but basically people have taken advantage of it, and now they're trying to not only use that to allow them to give unlimited amounts of money, but to also keep secret the amounts of people who are giving those unlimited amounts of money. So you don't even have disclosure, which everybody has agreed for a long time is a minimum that should be required. The problems with this system are many. The main one is it diverts the attention of Congress, of members of Congress, from where their attention is supposed to be. The Founding Fathers intended that those people in Congress are supposed to be worried about and be faithful to what the vote, what a majority of the voters want. That's supposed to be their primary dependency. Mm-hmm. The campaign finance system has created a different and second dependency. Namely campaign, those small people, that small group of people who can afford to finance campaigns. And that is the way that it corrupts the system and prevents our government from working the way that's intended. It's also thought, although this is a subject of some argument about this, that the system probably increases partisanship and decreases the representation of more moderate people in the middle on both parties, and decreases the possibilities for compromise, because a lot of these people can be funded by rich people who tend to be more at one extreme or the other. That's just the way it sort of works out. And as a result, it results in a more partisan, more gridlock system, and one that is not really as responsive to the desires and the political sensibilities of the vast majority of the people in this country. Now, let me make clear one issue before I get the Tribune jumping on me for engaging in class war. I am not saying that it's wrong for rich people to contribute to campaigns. What I am saying is, it's wrong for us to have a campaign finance system that is dependent on the largesse of rich people, because that diverts the attention of our congressmen from the population at large to that small group of rich people who can afford that. There are plenty of rich people who do great things, who fund medical research, who fund political research, who fund social research, who fund anti-poverty programs, who fund all kinds of wonderful things. And I'm not saying that rich people don't have a right to have political representation. They do. But what they don't have a right to do is have a small group of rich people basically dominate the thinking and the ears of our congressmen and our senators. The basic problem is this. We all agree, or at least most of us, I think, can agree, we want a democracy, right?
Yes. Yes.
And in the in a representative democracy or republic, we have to have campaigns by politicians to get elected. You have to have elections in democracy. Campaigns cost money. In a bigger and more complex society, there's no way around the fact that campaigns cost money. The question is, who's going to pay that money? Who's going to pay that bill for the democracy? Should we have the general public paying for that, in which case the congresspeople will presumably be more responsive, the general public will be funding their campaigns? Or should we be looking to leave it to a few rich people and a few special interests who decide that it's in their interest to pay for that system? I think the answer is fairly obvious. We have a systemic problem here. The public needs to pay for the democracy that we want. We all can and should do that. Now, let me deal with some of the issues that are likely to come up, or some of the questions I get when I say this. First, one thing that people don't realize is by having this type of system, we make it profitable for certain special interests to buy government power and government's ability to affect other economic issues. Many of these special interests make their money back from their campaign contributions in very obvious ways. So, for instance, we have a group of sugar growers in this country. They protect the sugar and growing industry in the United States. It's a relatively small industry, but because they get protection, they can make monopoly profits on their sugar. Consumers overpay for sugar in the U.S. by about $2 to $3 billion a year because of this. They make that back. They can afford to turn some of that into campaign contributions to make sure that the tariffs against importing sugar remain in place. Another obvious example is some of the defense contractors who have very large defense contracts that they want to protect. There are very sophisticated political schemes for dividing that work up around the country, to have jobs around the country, and for making a fair amount in political contributions to all the important people on the committees in Congress that fund these programs. They get that money back in the payments that they get for the military systems and the military things that they supply to our military. Remember, our government has a budget that's in the trillions of dollars. Our total campaign finance system costs someplace around $6 to $10 billion. So people can make that money back. It's not that high a percentage of what our government actually spends in total, about 1/300. That raises a second question. Can we afford to publicly pay for elections? The answer is very clearly yes. The total amount that we spend on elections is less than the income. Some individual companies in this country make more in profits than our total election system costs, campaigns. So yes, we can afford it. There's no question about it. It's a small, small percentage of what we pay in defense. Remember, we have a defense system to defend our way of life in this country and defend us against aggressors. One of the key things it's supposed to defend is our right to democracy. We may need to take a little bit of that, I mean a relatively small amount, and divert it into financing, public financing of campaigns to help defend the continued existence of that democracy so that we do not become a plutocracy where we're simply being ruled by and for the benefit of rich people. The second question I get is, how are you going to prevent money from being wasted if you have a public campaign financing system? You'll have everybody and their brother running and applying for money. Well, there are ways to prevent that, and they've actually been proven in practice. So one way to do that is what we call a small donor matching system. This is the system, type of system that New York City currently uses to fund its mayoral campaigns. So that a candidate needs to go out and raise a certain minimum number of small contributions, say $200 from 1,000 people or 10,000 people. The city then matches that at a ratio of 4 or 5 to 1. Now, there are other twists that you can put on that system. You can force the candidate to agree that they won't accept any large contributions as a result of participating in the system. There are other things you can do. But you can't tweak it so that you only get serious candidates who are going to actually get the public funding in any significant amount. You can also use a voucher system. Larry Lessig describes this in some detail in his books, where basically you could say, we're going to take the first $50 from every U.S. taxpayer tax return, and instead of applying it to the general treasury, we're going to apply it to fund the campaign financing system. And contrary to what you may have heard on some places, most people in this country, and certainly all working people, pay at least $50 into the government. Maybe not in income taxes for all of them, but certainly in FICA and other taxes. The other questions I hear say, that's a radical proposal. Can't we just fix the existing system that we have? And my answer increasingly is, I believe in putting limits on campaign contributions. I've believed in it since the 70s. But the current system is not working, and the monkey wrenches that the Supreme Court keeps throwing into it to make it more complicated, and the loopholes that are being found, make that system increasingly ineffective and unwieldy, and make it basically a dead letter, in my view. We can't fix that for very fundamental reasons. The Supreme Court does have some legitimate points. While I don't agree with much of what it said in many of the recent decisions, there is some legitimate arguments about the extent to which people have a right to spend money in running for office. And we risk protecting incumbents unduly if we say you can only spend so much to contest for an election. Those are serious concerns, and I'd be seriously concerned if we did try to put those kinds of limits on people. Let me make this point. There's a lot of noise out there about the problems with the campaign finance system. And I know that some people say, well, if we just reverse the Supreme Court decision in Citizens United, that's what we need to do. So we can pass a constitutional amendment to overrule the Supreme Court decision. Let me tell you what the problem with that is. The problem with that is that on January 20th, 2010, the day before the Supreme Court decision issued its decision, Citizens United, this system was still broke. Super PACs already existed. Now, Citizens United made it worse, but it didn't create the problem. The basic problem remains that if we're going to rely on rich people to fund our campaigns, we're going to have a problem. The only question is the size of that problem. Redistricting has also been talked about, and there's a proposal to amend the redistricting process in Illinois. And in general, I think redistricting reform is a good idea, although I think it would be better if it approached on a nationwide basis rather than piecemeal by certain states while letting other states take advantage of gerrymandering. But redistricting clearly will not solve this problem. It simply means that you have different candidates fighting over these money issues, but the money issues will in no way be going to go away. Another thing that won't solve it is term limits.
Ah, I love you.
All term limits would do is essentially transfer power, to some extent, from members of the legislature into the hands of the party officials and the other people who would then be pulling strings behind the scenes. This is essentially a lot like what we had in the 19th century. And it's not so unlike what we have in Congress today, where it's said that really being a member of Congress is simply being part of a farm team. You're a farm team then for K Street, which is lobbying firms, where 50% of our retiring Senate members now go to work for K Street. Why? Because they get a raise and they get an increase in their salary of about 1,000%, about a 10-time increase in their salary by going to work for K Street. They know the people on the Hill, they can lobby them. So time in Congress is viewed as a time on the farm team. The real money is to be made after they get out of Congress and move to K Street. That's another problem with the system. So while I'm all for trying to get the Supreme Court to take a more realistic view of problems with campaign finance, to take a more expansive view of what corruption is that justifies state regulation of campaign finances, I'm not holding my breath on that, and that will not solve our problem. What will solve our problem ultimately is public financing for elections. Now, how do we get there? This is a problem that's discussed to some extent in the Lawrence Lessig books and by a number of other commentators that are out there. The problem is getting there is a very politically difficult thing to do, because right now a lot of power is in the hands of people who like the current system. So the first and most important step at the moment in moving towards some sort of public financing system is simply educating the public, convincing the public as to what the heart of the problem is and how to fix it. Because if we waste our time, spending great time and energy to, say, pass a constitutional amendment overruling Citizens United, we're going to discover that we haven't solved the problem. But it's going to take us 20 or 30 years to discover that. We've already had 20 or 30 years with this type of campaign limits system. We've seen the problems with it, and we've discovered what the real problem is, and that's that we can't rely on rich people to pay for our democracy. We have to pay for it ourselves. Now, there are various proposals out there that exist. There have been various bills introduced in Congress over the past few years. There was another one this year introduced by Congressman Sarbanes and a couple other people that proposed public financing in congressional elections. There are local initiatives to try and change things, like the New York City public financing for its mayoral elections. That proposal is now being taken to the New York legislature with a request, a fight over whether they're going to adopt that kind of system for their entire state.
We don't have
and that's just been introduced in the New York legislature.
Here, I'll be right back.
We have proposed pilot projects here in Illinois, and we still want to pursue them.
Did I give you your check?
We think there are at least two ways in which we could do some pilot projects here in Illinois.
Thank you.
One would be to start with the area of judicial campaign financing, which I mentioned earlier. The vast majority of people in this area agree that judges should not have to raise money to run in an election. And they recognize the dangers of corruption that go with requiring judges to do so. There is, accordingly, I think, fairly widespread public support if you come up with a viable system for publicly financing some judicial campaign finance elections. It would not be very expensive because those campaigns are not very expensive on the overall basis. And it would be a good test system to demonstrate to the public that the system can work. So that is one area where we've been pushing over the years to try and create some public financing of elections as a demonstration project, essentially, to show that this could work and could be extended to the broader public system. A second area we could do something in would be to try and create some local initiatives like the New York City initiative with some cooperating localities here in the area. That's a second alternative that we intend to look at, that we haven't really explored that much to date. But any of these are going to require, as I said, public education as to what the real nature of our problem is and what is the real basic problem that we need to solve with our campaign finance system. And that is, as I said, if we want democracy, we're going to be willing to put the
ice cream.
So, with that, I am completing my presentation, and I would welcome hearing other points of view.
All right. Yeah, let's all reform everything, yeah.
Now, listen, I'll call on people, and sure. Of course, you'll be the one that answers the questions, not me. All right, who's got a question? Tim, go ahead.
Is there any country or area right now that does campaign financing right? And if so, can you elaborate?
I have to confess that I do not know internationally the extent to which it's done, and I'm not confident that internationally there's a good system that's worth looking at as a model. But I can tell you this. There are, out of the 50 states in the United States, about 25 of them have experimented with different public financing systems and are continuing to increasingly experiment with public financing systems. And there are other states that exist as good models that we could look to here in Illinois in adopting measures. And actually, there was a campaign task force here in Illinois which issued a report a couple years ago which looked at those extensively. And there are a number of other states that could provide good models for Illinois, basically. So, for instance, North Carolina had a good system for publicly financing judicial elections. The Supreme Court raised some problems with it, and it has to be modified. Has to be modified.
What's that? Excuse me, just a moment. What's that noise?
There are systems around the country that we could look to as models for public financing. Now, they continue to be under attack from right-wing interests, which continue to attack public financing schemes, basically to try and keep them from being a viable alternative. So this is a fight that's going on. Things are moving at the Supreme Court level, not necessarily in a good direction, but there are examples out there that we can look to. And if you get the Illinois Task Force on Public Campaign Financing that was done, I think, last year, you will find an extensive discussion of those things.
What was it called again? Just as a follow-up, the Illinois Task Force?
Right, it's an Illinois Campaign Finance Task Force report. I believe it came out either in March of 2013 or 2012. If you send me an email, I can send you a copy of it and a link to it. It's on the state's website.
All right. Gary, did you have a question?
Yeah. You said we need to educate the people.
Yeah.
Here in Illinois, we just had a primary election for the gubernatorial race, and hardly anybody showed up for it. I guess the question is, what do we do to make, education or not, what do we do to make people actually care? And secondly, what do you think about this billionaire who finances his own campaign for governor? That just wanted to,
yes, Bruce Rauner.
So
let me take the second question first, Bruce Rauner. I don't have any position. Like I say, we're bipartisan. We try not to take partisan positions. But I would say that millionaire campaigns like Bruce Rauner and Oberweiss are going to be increasingly the norm if we continue with the current campaign financing system, because they're going to have to be the only people who have enough money to run. And I don't think that's a good, I think that's a bad thing.
All right.
What was the first part of the first part of the question?
How do you make people care?
How do you make people care? So the low turnout, it can be a problem. But remember, in presidential election years, we do get a relatively high turnout, 60 to 70% when it's a really contested election. So one of the issues with low turnout in primaries is you can read too much into that. So for instance, on the Democratic side this time, you did not have many races that were really of interest to the voters, because voters do not generally get interested in many races below the top races for governor or president or senator. Even though you had some competitive races for judges and for things like Metropolitan Water Commission that were important, they don't sink down to the level that the general public gets very interested in, and I don't know of any way to make them interested in those things. So the basic problem, in my view, with the low turnout in primaries is many times you don't have reasons for people to turn out. You didn't have much reason for Democrats to turn out in this last primary. In Democratic areas, you got turnouts that were below 10% in some cases. The real interest was on the Republican side because of the governor's race.
All right. Joe, did you have a question?
Yes. There's one state in the United States that has a unicameral legislature. would that represent a solution for some of these problems?
I don't think so, because whether it's unicameral or bicameral, you're still going to have the problem of those people needing to raise money. If you think that it's unicameral, they're going to need to raise even more money, be more like a Senate campaign, that's going to be more expensive. So, no, I don't think that, I think that deals with other issues. There are other reasons why you might want to make that kind of reform, and that those could be debated. But I don't think that that the campaign finance aspect of it is affected by whether it's unicameral or bicameral.
All right. We got a lot of hands up. Dave Travis, did you have a question?
Yes. Why not restore the First Amendment right by allowing people to donate all they want to a campaign and let the chips fall where they may?
Well, that's pretty much the system that we have now with super PACs. That's what it's evolved to, is basically that for most people, the system of campaign finance limits has become meaningless. They can raise unlimited amounts of money through a super PAC that they technically do not coordinate with. So in large part, we already have that system, and we see where the chips fall. The chips fall inside of the rich people who are financing campaigns. That's who Congress people listen to, and that's whose interests they're going to pay attention to. And that's bad for the country overall.
All right. Dave Travis, another Dave. You got a question.
Dave Zucker.
Dave Zucker, I'm sorry. A thousand apologies. Thank you. Dave Zucker, go ahead.
I have two questions. First of all, we in Illinois adopted the second half of what was once called the Missouri Plan, where incumbent judges run for retention.
Correct.
But we never adopted the first half of the plan that favored appointment of judges.
Correct.
One, how do you feel about that? And two, how do you feel about making voting compulsory, as the case in Australia and New Zealand?
Right. I've actually talked to some people from Australia about this. There's actually a woman here who works for the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights, who's from Australia. I have mixed feelings about compulsory voting for this reason. My basic question about it is, if people are not interested enough to come vote in an election, do we really want to force those people, namely the most uninformed or most uninterested, to the polls to help decide those elections? Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
Do you want dumbbells to vote?
All right, hold on. All right,
appointment of judges. You're absolutely right that when we adopted the Missouri system, we did not adopt the first part, which called for appointment of judges. I think appointment of judges is a better way to go, although that you do have to put in a lot of protections to assure that it doesn't become an old boys club, making the appointments. But that can be done. And in my view, appointments ultimately, it's still not an apolitical system, but it's a better system and results in less unqualified judges getting to the bench.
All right, now let's see. Sid, go ahead.
There's been two periods in our history where we made a lot of reforms. During the turn of the century, not this century, the other century,
right.
20th century, where these big corporations were monopolized.
Right.
And we made a number of reforms that they couldn't do that. And during the Roosevelt administration, you also had a lot of reforms. And the tax was very, very high, maybe 91%, and now it's only about 15 or something like that. And so how would you keep these things from not going back to where it was?
Not going back to where it was, you mean to the 90% tax rate and that kind of thing?
No. What I mean is, you make reforms, and then the reforms are canceled out.
I got you. The only way you can, the only way, to answer your last question, the only way you can do that is by having citizens that are sufficiently engaged that they are constantly fighting to protect their own rights and liberties. Yeah. If you don't have that, ultimately the system is going to fail. People are going to find ways to get around it and to corrupt it the way our current campaign finance system does. And it's going to fail. So the ultimate protection is the interest of the citizens at large. If you don't have that, you are fighting a losing battle and trying to protect their liberties. That's why the first step in really doing campaign finance reform is just educating the public as to what the basic nature of the problem is and what the basic solution is.
Okay, Charlie, did you have a question?
Yeah, David. For any number of years, I've qualified as a relevant funder. according to the text you recommended, my name has been used to advance certain appointees. Do I look like a one percenter to you?
Well, if you're
who has undue influence
I would tell you this,
over probably. American politics, or do I look like a regular Joe?
Can you effectively channel several thousand dollars into a political campaign for a local politician?
I've funded enough to be a relevant funder.
Well, but I told you...
My name has been used.
My name has been used too, but that doesn't really mean you're a relevant funder. Okay, people send out calling people relevant funders and
no, it has been
and so
used.
On.
Yeah, I know it.
The real number of relevant funders are the numbers I quoted earlier. For congressional campaigns, which is what the main focus of this talk was, you're talking about people who are going to be giving in excess of $100,000 each election cycle. Now, I don't know about you, Charlie. I can't afford to do that.
No,
that means I'm not really a relevant funder.
No, it's not that I...
You can be a person who gets the ear of politicians, particularly local politicians, at lower amounts of money. But if you really want them to listen to you and you really want them to not only send you letters and take your call occasionally, but actually do things that you want done, you're going to have to contribute substantially more than you're talking about. The numbers I talked about are the actual numbers from 2010 election. All right.
Move on. That's not out of
all right,
system.
We've got a lot of questions. Brom, did you have a question?
Yes. Would it help to have a sort of a parallel to franking privileges for congressmen?
Yeah.
That is, not only for congressional and national candidates, but also for local and state candidates, that perhaps they should have at least two mailings that would...
There's actually been a more far-reaching things that have been proposed, and here's why I don't think they would be that much, would help that much, would be that much solution. So one thing that has been proposed is, remember, technically the public owns the airwaves over which our television systems travel. Technically the government funded the internet, and a lot of what goes over the internet, we could require that be made freely available to candidates. We could require that broadcast time on TV stations and on cable stations be made available free to candidates. My concern is this. All that will do is create a foundation from which all people can start out equal, and then there'll be more unequal built on that. So it'll basically result in even more commercials and more airtime, but people will still use their money advantage under the existing system to buy more commercials and to build on top of that. So I don't think that's an ultimate solution to the problem. But it wouldn't hurt to give people more public access time and that kind of thing.
All of these are what I'd call bourgeois reforms. So why don't we simply go to the socialist revolution?
Yeah, we don't want to bourgeois reforms of the bourgeoisie.
Yes. Oh, go ahead, Pat.
Yeah, far be it from me to discourage people from placing ads in newspapers and magazines. I work for a newspaper, but... are we reaching the point where, I mean, it was getting ridiculous this past week,
yes,
to the point where I would think even the most serious political junkie would zone out every time he heard a commercial, and yes, this is great for the ad people, but do you reach a point of diminishing returns where you do overkill, and it's like, you know, when our teacher would say, don't do something, if he or she said it five times, we took it seriously.
Yeah.
If she or he said it 100 times, we were deaf to it by that time.
Yes.
Are we at that point where this is numbing people into a state of deeper apathy than we've got?
I think we are at that point. I think you can argue strongly that there is evidence that we are at that point with respect to things like television and print ads. Okay. which is where most of the money, when you've had more money traditionally, has gone into in political campaigns. But, and I think you can see that that reaches a point of diminishing returns if you look at the results of the 2012 elections, where a lot of money was poured into some races with only minimal results in terms of ending up with a candidate you wanted winning. But what I think that shows is that these large money, these increasingly large money campaigns have a lot to learn, but they are not stupid. They spent a lot of money. Arguably, they wasted a fair amount of it in 2012 and 2008. But I think that as time goes on, they're going to get a lot smarter about how they spend that money. So you'll see it going not only into increases in ads and that kind of thing, you'll see it being spent more effectively. For instance, right now, as I understand it, the Koch brothers, in the last, in that election that just took, a special election that took place in Florida, they spent a considerable amount of money on trying to finance the ground game, to get out the vote, to identify the voters and get them out to the polls, ground game to increase the effectiveness of the money that they're spending in campaigns. So over time, I think these large amounts of money will become more effective. But yes, I agree with you that you do reach a point where the additional money going into ads and so on reaches a saturation point and it's just wasted money.
All right, did you have a question?
Yes, I agree with the idea of lobbying the government, but what you mentioned, some governments have hired lobbyists. What do they do?
So they represent your local government in lobbying members of the state legislature. Now, there are various people, there are people who defend this, and it is defensible in the sense that frequently members of the legislature may be representing multiple municipalities where those municipalities are all fighting for something, say an off-ramp or a particular civic center or investment in a particular area, where each of them needs to make their case to the particular legislator. But my concern is not so much that people are doing that or hiring those lobbyists, although I do think I agree with you, it's a little odd to think of government units hiring lobbyists to lobby other government units within the same government. You would think that they can go to their own representatives and discuss things directly with them. But what particularly concerns me and what I particularly object to is when those entities, those local government units, do not have to disclose that they're doing this and do not have to disclose how much taxpayer money they're spending on it and why they're doing it.
All right. I see a couple of hands, Charlie and Joe, but first, before I get into a second round of questions, is there anyone who has a question who has not already asked a question? Okay, Andy.
The question I had that runs through this, what should be done about Citizens United and the fact that they're just buying and selling our politicians in Congress right now?
Well, I think that in the long run, the best thing that can be done about Citizens United is to continue to elect a Democratic majority to the for the Senate and have a Democratic president who are making the judicial appointments to, in the long run, the balance on the Supreme Court, which in my view has gotten much been captured by radical conservatives, essentially.
What can be done in the short term?
In the short term, there's not much we can do about Citizens United other than we can push it to at least improve the disclosure rules so at least people who sit give money to super PACs cannot hide behind bad administrative rules that allow them to hide the identities of the donors. We can change those rules with the IRS, and there's an effort going on within the IRS to change those rules and require disclosure of those donors. So that's one thing that we can do in terms of eliminating the worst part of super PACs. But for the most part, the other thing we can do is get the Federal Election Commission to adopt meaningful rules that actually do prevent super PACs from coordinating with campaigns. Right now, the rules on what constitutes coordination are kind of a joke. And you don't have to take that from me. You can look online at anything that Stephen Colbert or John Stewart has done about the coordination rules, and you'll see that.
All right. Now, Mike, do you have a question?
Sure.
Go ahead.
I don't want to sound like I'm taking a shot at you, because you said a lot of things that need to be said. But if we have public funding of campaigns, do you really think that these elected officials will not take millions of dollars a year in bribe money, will not suck up to lobbyists, will not suck up to super PACs, will not suck up to rich people to get more bribe money?
That's a very good question. I do not think that a public finance system will solve that problem. I think we continue to have laws against bribery, against all those kinds of things you mentioned, okay? And we continue to need to enforce them. What I do think is, right now we have a system where we force every politician to basically go sell their soul to raise the money they need for a campaign. Some people will continue to sell their souls if they can put that money in their pocket somehow, but that behavior is basically illegal and they'll hopefully get prosecuted for it, like Randy Cunningham did, like Rod Blagojevich did, like others have in the past. But it will not solve all those problems, but it will do this. It will allow those people who are in government for the right reasons not to have to go sell their souls to get elected. And that will be an improvement in the system in getting more fair-minded and more reasonable legislators in there than we have now. So no, it won't be a complete solution, but it will be an important step.
Okay, Ernie, did you have a question?
Yeah. What do you think of term limits? How could do you think term limits are a good idea, and would they be a partial solution to some of these problems?
I personally do not believe in term limits. I believe we have term limits already to hold elections, so that if a congressional district wants to vote for the same candidate, they like how their representative is representing them, I think they should have the right to do that. The other problem I see with term limits is I do not see it solving this problem with campaign finance. I actually see that it would probably make the system worse. If you look at places that have enacted term limits, what happens is basically one of two things. First, you get legislatures playing game of musical chairs like they sometimes do in California, where first they're a representative, then they run for this office, then they run for that office. They just do a musical chair running for different offices and rotate. But the bigger problem with term limits is this. It doesn't take the money out of the system. It simply transfers who is really controlling the flow of that money from the individual politician to a party official, so that you're going to have more power exercised behind the scenes, basically people pulling the strings of the politicians who will then be funneling the money to them, but you're still going to have the same type of corruption that we have with the current system.
All right, now I see that there were just, let me just call on, now is there anybody? Okay, Mike, did you have a question?
Yeah, well, it was a good point about, Browner. It looked like the Republicans really wanted to put in Dillard, but money put Browner in. So that's crazy. My question is, don't you guys think you should look at a foreign country where the model is there in place, where they do have public funding?
A lot of foreign countries have similar problems with how they fund their elections.
Well, no,
now, they do have better systems. They have better systems because they don't have local they have better national election systems that eliminate some of the problems we have, because we have the variations with having local election authorities that control different things and work in varying degrees effectively. So there are a lot of things to look at in the international models in terms of changing the way our elections are administered. And I agree with that. There's a good book out on that.
We'll take the money out of politics. Well, you guys should look at that model.
But it doesn't take the funding issue out of it, because what happens in foreign countries is you still get private interest funding those campaigns. So to a certain extent, you still have that issue. You have it to a lesser extent than you have it in this country, because the campaigns are shorter in many cases, and less intense and lengthy than they are in this country, so the amounts of money being spent is smaller. But you still have that problem in a lot of foreign countries. But I don't disagree with you. I would be happy to look at foreign country models, and I agree with you. That would be a reasonable place to look and see what's out there.
All right. Now, is there anybody else,
Julian,
who has a question?
Yes, ma'am.
Who has not already asked a question? No?
Okay.
All right. Well, I have one question that I'd like to ask.
My friend.
Now, you mentioned earlier in your lecture that in your opinion, campaign finance. Okay, well, I've been accused of talking too loud, so I've tried to modulate my voice.
Too much.
All right. How does all this this campaign financing by rich people increase the amount of partisanship?
The way it increases the amount of partisanship is a subject of debate among the experts. And we can't say for certain that it does, but it seems to, because it seems that many of the rich people who are most interested in funding campaigns are most interested in funding them because they are at the extremes in the political parties on their issues. So if they're the ones that are funneling most of the money in, then that's where the candidates are going to gravitate to, and the candidates are going to do what they have to keep those people happy, even if those people are taking positions that may not be that popular among the majority of the general voters.
All right. Well, if I may ask you another, just a quick follow-up question. I would not disagree with you that, for example, the Koch brothers, who largely fund the Republican Party or fund Republican candidates, are can be considered on the far right extreme. But do you consider the main funders of the Democratic Party to be left-wing extremists?
I don't, but some people do.
Okay.
Well,
I guess all right. Now we can go into a second round of questions. Joe, you had your hand up. Go ahead.
Thank you very much. I'm very discouraged by the so-called campaign literature, the so-called debates. They never deal with the issue, but tend to obscure the real agenda of the candidates. Is there some way we can correct that?
I don't know of any good way to correct that other than encouraging people to be better citizens, more informed, more incisive, and not willing to support candidates who are just going to mouth cliches and not really address the issues. It's not unusual, as you know, in elections to get campaigns where neither candidate is really willing to address key controversial issues, because I think they have nothing to gain from it. I think that's a problem for our democracy, and the only way to change it is to the voters to force those candidates to address those issues if they want to get those voter support.
All right. Now, Charlie, did you have a question?
Yeah, I briefly represented a woman who got fired from her job and decided then, since she was unemployed, to run for Congress. And the other day she won in the primary. Now, this woman thinks that God is angry with the state of Illinois.
She was right about that.
And causing tornadoes. And do you think we should give this woman money? And Brahm wants to give her franking privileges just so she could send us literature. Woman is squirrely. She got squirrely in my office. And you want to give her what?
The question is, do a majority of the voters in the election agree that she's squirrely? Now, I personally think that if she's that squirrely, that will come out during the campaign, and she will not get a majority of the votes in the general election.
She's going to get money.
She's going to get money. She's entitled to run. All right. And if we have a serious democracy, we have to have contested elections. That's not to say if she can't raise money, if she's so squirrely that she can't raise money from a minimum, you know, from a broad base of small contributors, then I wouldn't give her money. She wouldn't qualify for the matching funds.
All right.
That's how you keep the squirrely candidates out.
Sir, do you have a question? No? Okay. Thought you had your hand up. All right. Who else? Tim, did you have another question?
Yeah, I want to know about the dynamics of the two-party system in Chicago, and I'll preface it with one question. Cubs or Sox fan?
All right. Now, we haven't got much time to waste then.
Well, we got I played
the fifth. We only got 35 minutes for rebuttals.
Yes.
Okay. My question for you is, why can't we let the candidates print their own money?
We actually have, so one of the voucher systems does not allow the candidates to print their own money, but it does allow the voters essentially to direct the first $50 of their tax payment through a voucher system to the candidate of their choice, and that's one of the ways of funding publicly funded elections.
All right.
So it's not as strange a question, but I'm not in favor of allowing candidates to print money generally. I'm allowing favor for people maybe being able to direct some of their money to cash.
All right. Now, are there any more questions? Go ahead.
In many foreign countries, they have a parliamentary system, which means there are many parties. Each party, no matter how small, represents a certain number of people,
right,
a certain percentage of the electorate. Would that work in the United States?
I think there are pluses and minuses to a parliamentary system. I'm not personally convinced that the benefits outweigh the disadvantages. If you look at the political histories in the other countries that have parliamentary systems, like Britain, Germany, Israel, a number of the other European countries. But it's a fair subject for debate. I think there are certainly some aspects of parliamentary systems
thank
that maybe
you.
We could
thank
incorporate into our current system without going to a totally parliamentary system and still improve our system.
All right. Now, I have just been informed by Charlie that we are running out of time for a rebuttal period. We're getting into a time crunch here. So we started a little bit later than our traditional starting time of 6. So what I would like to do is end the questions now and go directly into the rebuttal period. But before we do that, let's have another round of applause for our speaker, Dave Melton. All right. Now what I would like to do is have a... first, I'll explain briefly how the rebuttal thing works. Now, these two chairs may be considered the on-deck chairs. You just get in line and kind of play musical chairs. This would be first in line, that's second in line. Just come on over here. I would recommend, we got two rebutters already coming up. Now, what I'd like to know, what I'd like to see is a show of hands of how many people wish to give a rebuttal speech. Everybody who wants to give a rebuttal speech, raise their hand. Okay, I'm going to start counting, but I want to keep... Y'all keep your hands up, please. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and that's, I have 12 already, Joe, so then I'm going to say 12 for the speaker. So I'm going to say 12. How much time we got, Charlie?
45 minutes or so.
Okay, Tim.
About 4 minutes apiece.
Four minutes apiece. Okay, right. Tim, is the timer on?
I got the online timer right here.
All right.
We're all
let's
set to go. And
all right,
David,
let's, all right.
David.
All right, let's go.
He's going to destroy this country.
He's going to destroy it. Excellent presentation. It's something we all needed to know and know that we can do something about it. But I will say that we get what we deserve. And we have to change it. We have to change our expectations so that we do get what we deserve. I do have a problem with some of the, as Brahm said, the bourgeois solutions to some of these problems. The party, the political party, was invented to represent the interests of those whose interests were...
Going up to four?
Specified or by the party. And I think that we can do that again. The parties that we have now are so broad in their perspective that it's hard for us to choose. The Tea Party came in with a very neat little problem, which was co-opted by industry, but nonetheless they did it. Those of us who want to see our particular interests represented need to have a party to do that as well. And there's only one way to do that, and that's by organizing that party.
All right, very good.
Thank the speaker. It gave me a lot to think about. I have some different opinions. I am certainly interested in move to amend, which I won't go into. But generally speaking, I agree with the speaker in the sense that you ought to do something yourself if you're a citizen. Tuesday I'll be in Springfield, okay? I'm going with one north side to Springfield to talk about making sure that corporations in Illinois have to declare publicly how much income taxes they do or do not pay. But anyway, through Jane Addams Senior Caucus on One North Side, I know my state representative, Cassidy Kelly, that you mentioned, state senator Heather Staines, Representative Jan Schakowsky, my alderman, I see him face to face, so at least I don't say I have influence, but Jane Addams certainly has influence, and we come back to see if they did what they were supposed to do. This is called good citizenry. This is, if everyone did this, I think we would be slightly better off than we are now. So I would recommend that we get our own education. Also in Jane Addams, we're going to have voter registration, voter education, and turnout, so that we get out those people that are in favor of what the things that we are in favor in of. And we're starting this at, we just promoted Saskia, one of our organizers, to do that. So those are the things you can do, but you got to be involved. I spend a lot of time on it. It ain't easy, but look at the mess we got. As far as I'm concerned, we don't have a democracy. We've got either a plutocracy or a... or worse than that. Okay, thank you.
All right. All right.
When our country started out, the only people that could vote is white people with land. And through struggle,
white men.
Other people came in, like the labor movement after a while, the women's movement, the black struggle movement, and things of that nature. But at the same time, these small farmers grew bigger, some of them started businesses, and some of them, after a period of time, got richer so they could buy out other businesses. So what happened was, we got monopoly in the economic system. And that monopoly, they stopped it to a certain degree at the turn of the century, not this century, last century. And so we got a little bit of progress there in 1933, Roosevelt came in there, and we got other reforms. But at the same time, monopolies kept growing and growing and growing. If you lived around the 40s or 50s, you'd walk around neighborhoods, see all small businesses. You don't hardly see that anymore. You see monopolies, like food stores or drug stores, pharmacies, and just about everything became monopolized. And what happens is you got the 1%. How are you going to solve that problem? You have to have economic democracy. Not only political democracy. In other words, the people that work for a living have to share the wealth with their fellow workers. Not one or two families own all these monopolies. When you have that type of system like we have now, an oligarchy, what happens is no matter what laws that you put into place, these monopolies will get around the laws with money. So that's the only way to really solve the problem. Now, you could put a Band-Aid on cancer, but it's not going to help much. Or sometimes it helps for a little while. But then it starts getting worse again because monopolies keep growing stronger. And that's our problem.
Very enormous.
These guys want to take over.
Very much enjoyed your talk, David, and I'm glad there are people like you who are willing to leave a very lucrative business or practice to get in and do work on behalf of the public in general. And I know a few such people, and I'm happy to somewhat know you now. Just very briefly, I've always suspected that the reason we're losing the war on getting problems out of campaign financing for the same reason we're losing the war on drugs. And that is we're attacking supply. We're trying to control supply. And that almost never works, no matter what the topic is. If it's something people want that's illegal, or if it's campaign money or whatever, it finds its way in, no matter how you try and regulate the supply. If you regulate demand, you can do something. In the case of drugs, we could essentially legalize and control them. That would put the illegal drug dealers largely out of business. And in the case of campaign finance, we could take the very expensive aspects of campaigns and just simply make them illegal. Make candidates start out when they're new and at a lower level, go to PTA meetings and bowling alleys and the College of Complexes and places like that to get themselves known. Perhaps some limited number of signatures needed to get on the ballot. Right now, that whole thing is very corrupt. There's certainly in Illinois, it's very corrupt. In that the people who are in office have to get almost no signatures to get on the ballot. And if somebody new wants to break in, they have to get huge numbers of signatures. But yes, get rid of the TV commercials. Make the TV commercials illegal. Replace them by frequent public televised debates and seminars and forums and town hall meetings, in addition to live town hall meetings in various locales. Get them off TV, get them off radio, and I hope you have your nitroglycerin ready here, Pat. Also, ban newspaper advertising at any large, and mailing of these large color brochures, these very expensive color brochures. I got three or four of them from a number of judicial candidates in this last election, and it's very irritating because I know this is money that could be going to something much, much better than that. So that's my basic suggestion is attack demand, and I do believe in term limits. I know we had a short discussion on that before. My comment to your comment would be, why is it then, if elections do such a good job of pruning bad leaders out, is even in highly contested elections for the U.S. Congress, over 90% of people are reelected every time? Thank you.
Sorry about that. This author, this writer, C. Wright Mills, wrote a very powerful, interesting, and great book a long time ago. Actually, I think it was in the 1950s, called The Power Elite. And he described this system, this political system that we live under, pretty well. And he described how it's an elite game. We have a ruling club in this country. We have an upper class that controls the system. These representatives, quote unquote, are recruited into this ruling club. They're invited in. For instance, Obama, Barack Obama. Paul Street wrote a couple books on Obama that explained very clearly in detail how he was vetted by the power elite and funded by the power elite, and just, just driven right into the whole system. So it's no surprise that his policies favor the 1% more than anybody else. So the problem is really the representative system itself. The problem is that we have these quote-unquote representatives, these intermediaries between the people and the policies that they want. So what we need is a national democracy where the people can decide on policies directly and skip these representatives who represent the rich more than anything else. Our speaker said that the founders were wanted the people to control things, wanted the people to define policy. Well, that's actually not, I'm sorry to say it's not true. The principal founders, like James Madison, knew the difference between a republic, a representative system, and a national democracy. And they wanted the former, not the latter. They were utterly anti-democratic. They were through elitists through and through. The anti-federalists, those were the federalists. The anti-federalists, who we don't hear about. Has anybody heard about the anti-federalists? Okay, most ordinary people, most ordinary Americans have never heard about the anti-federalists, who were the actual Democrats, and they lost because what was adopted was an actual oligarchy. So these reforms that you have brought to us, that you advocate, are fine, but they're totally inadequate. They're tinkering around the edges. We need a completely new system, an actual democracy, and that would consist of community assemblies throughout the country where people decide on issues directly. And then the executive or bureaucratic part of the government would be random sample councils where people would be chosen by lot, or sortition is another term for that. So we wouldn't have elections at all. The problem is not election reform, that we don't have election reform. The problem is that we have elections. We have to get rid of elections. We have to get rid of this entire political system that we're living under.
No election.
So that's about what I have to say. And Bob, one of my colleagues, mentioned to you all that we're having this forum, the Democracy Forum. And I just want to say really quickly, Paul Street, he emailed me just yesterday. His new book is actually already out. It's called They Rule, the 1% versus Democracy. So our forum is going to be something of a book signing. And we have flyers, and our website is democracyfortheusa.org. Thanks a lot.
No election.
Mike Foley. Yes, my name is Michael Foley.
The flyer?
The priority one function of government has two parts. Part A is government exists to provide bribes for politicians and jobs for precinct captains.
Right.
And I'm not opposed to a precinct captain having a job. Part B, why government exists, is government exists to destroy people's lives. Now, if anybody disagrees with those two things, that's okay. The way I can substantiate those remarks is saying, for at least 50 years that I know of, that's what government has done in this country, all levels of government. Now, I asked a question about bribery. I asked the guy at this public financing campaigns, do you think these politicians could be taking bribes? He started talking about bribery being illegal, blah, blah, blah. I know bribery is illegal. And the vast majority of politicians also know bribery is illegal. That's why if you ask every single elected official in this country, do you take bribe money? Yeah. I would guess that every single one of them would say, no, I don't take bribe money. And they don't. Not really. They take campaign contributions.
Yeah.
Politicians know that bribery is illegal, so they call their bribes campaign contributions, which are legal. We got this guy in Illinois, I think his name is Derek Smith. He's a legislator in Springfield. He got kicked out of the government for taking a $7,000 bribe. And actually what his crime was being stupid. He took $7,000 cash to put in a fix for a constituent. All he had to do was mark it down on a piece of paper, and you submit this paper to whoever, and call it $7,000 campaign contribution. And he would, in fact, he would have been praised. Man, you're a sharp guy, you're a sharp guy. But the dummy took $7,000 cash, didn't tell anybody, thought he was being slick, and got in trouble. Now, the speaker also mentioned, and I'm not trying to take a shot at the speaker. I mean, he said a lot, like I said, when I asked my question, he said a lot of things that should be said and have to be said.
Tim?
Anyway, he said the average...
This is it. Can I give you another drink?
Senator
Sprite, root beer, coffee, tea?
$10.5 million. I did a quick math.
Okay.
It's $34,000 a week, every single week for 6 years. The guy gets elected to the Senate, he's got to go out and collect $34,000 a week, cash green money, every single week for 6 years. Rain or shine, day or night, $34,000. Think of that. I guess that everybody in this room understands $34,000. There's probably people in this room who have had jobs where they made less than $34,000 a year, and there are millions of people in this country living on less than $34,000 a year, and this vermin, scum, slime politicians take $34,000 a week, every single week for 6 years, and it is not bribery, it is all legal and lawful, it is a campaign contribution. Now why did he do this? There's another fact of life. Rich men have their women. These guys want to be big shots. They like broads. They like broads giving them oral sex. Laugh if you want. Jesse Jackson Jr. spent $40,000 on a wristwatch for his whore. He didn't buy that watch for himself, and he didn't buy that watch for his wife. He bought that watch for the whore that was giving him oral sex. That's why they're raising all this money. It's bribe money. It pays for their women. One of the quickest ways to get rich in this country and have a lot of excess cash flowing around is to be an elected official. You get your whore and you put her on the payroll, your campaign payroll.
Mike,
yeah,
time's up.
Okay,
yeah.
I'm done.
Okay.
Oh, boy, Mike.
Laugh if you want.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, when I heard one of the speakers say that Pat Butler should have his nitroglycerin ready, I think anyone who talks in his presence about banning newspaper advertising should be prepared for the fact that the nitro that Pat may have ready is the volatile kind that you throw.
Well done.
Second, with regard to the comment that Brown made about bourgeois reforms, next thing you know, Brown's going to have us all singing the International.
Right.
I agree with most of what the speaker said, and I, God help me, even agree with Mike Foley when he said that it needed to be said. Yes, it did. The only thing that the speaker and I disagreed about in your otherwise excellent talk was the subject of redistricting. Now, I am a staunch Chicago and Cook County Democrat, and I see nothing wrong with the present system of redistricting here in Illinois. What's unique about it is that this is the first time that we had a Democratic governor and a Democratic legislature, at least in my lifetime, and I'm going to be 60 on Monday, at the same time, so that we came up with a staunchly Democratic map. In the past, we would have come up with just as staunchly a Republican map. I didn't squawk then the way that the Republicans are squawking now, because I figured that that just went with the territory. And in this case, to see all these Republicans squawking is annoying. When they drew the map, they didn't squawk. And it wasn't any more or less unfair than what the Democrats came up with this time around. And I'm sorry, I think that the Democratic Party did a wonderful job of drawing up congressional and state redistricting. Put more Democrats in the U.S. House of Representatives. It enables the Democrats to keep control of the Illinois legislature. And my attitude toward that is hooray. The only thing that I would like to see personally is I would like to see Michael Madigan replaced, as I am not a fan of Mr. Madigan. I think he's responsible for much of what is wrong in Illinois political life today. Lastly, I will also say, however, that I looked with some perturbation at the choice for governor this time.
Perturbation.
The Democrats had a choice between Patrick Quinn, of whom I'm not necessarily an admirer, but will be forced to vote for, T.O. Hardeman, who I thought was even less qualified than Mr. Quinn, and my attitude toward the Republicans could be summed up as none of the above. As you had a choice there between Mr. Rauner, who thought he could buy his way, and so far quite successfully, toward the Republican nomination, and Mr. Dillard and the others. And you could see the influence of money, as our speaker pointed out there. Mr. Rauner had enough money to get the nomination. Mr. Dillard had to scrape for money at the last minute and almost made it, The other two couldn't raise any money and were never in the game at all. And I think that pretty much is about it. Thank you.
Oh, I voted with trepidation. They voted with trepidation.
And now the farm for the day.
Feels sorry for him. Oh, yeah, Butler's okay. Going to get up here.
You know,
ban newspapers.
In biblical times, they did have a sort of a demon god called Mammon, and it was really equivalent to money. And yes, they did rail against Mammon, the prophets of Israel did, and really that money is going to rule, whether directly in political campaign coffers or in society. I mean, I'm sure that every pastor knows that there are the big contributors at church or in the synagogue, or and they do try not to offend them. Okay, and that's because things have to work, and money makes the wheels go round. And when it comes to the press, or to radio or TV, the media generally, money does make the wheels go round, and you don't want to offend the big advertisers. And, you know, the utilities are big advertisers. The insurance agencies are big advertisers. The automobile industry is big advertiser. And, of course, the Emporia, the those who'll sell you stuff for your home and so on, the real estate lobby, all these lobbies are big advertisers too, so you're not going to be able to rely on the press for a critical evaluation of the policies that are engendered in Springfield or Washington regarding taxation of real estate. They have bankers really own a good deal of real estate. That is, they don't own it legally because that would make them pay taxes. But they really are profiting very much from the ownership of land. Oh well, but that's the way things go. They run the system, those with the means to do so. And they think that's right, and they are told in the universities by economists and so on that is the way things have to be. Well, they don't have to be just that way. You can think of a system of social democracy that would preclude that kind of control and make the society run for the needs and welfare of the people generally. And that kind of value is promoted by every liberation movement in our society that wants quality. The time is up. I would suggest Marxist humanists, and generally so aid liberation movements as to form a working class solidarity that will be effective in changing the system of government and of government of the workplace and of distribution.
All right.
All I can say is, if it is true that Jesse Jackson Jr. paid $40,000 for a watch in hopes of getting oral sex out of the deal, I can only thank our lucky stars that this man, while serving in Congress, was not on the Finance or Appropriations Committee, because he certainly would not have been spending the taxpayers' money any more wisely if he didn't know how to get more bang for the buck out of his own money.
You got more than one shot.
Hey, mate, one fool.
Seriously, I want to thank our speaker tonight for being right on the money, so to speak. It's no secret that this country has been headed toward a great division that we haven't seen since the days of the robber barons, between the have-nots and the have-too-muches. And we're seeing this division. We're seeing, you know, back in the old days, in the Gilded Age of our grandfathers and great-grandfathers' days, when the railroad interests, the mining interests, other big interests were able to buy Congress, lock, stock, and barrel. And an honest congressman or senator was a man who once bought, stayed bought. Our speaker spoke about the sugar interests lobbying very heavily in Congress today. It reminds me a little bit about the 1890s, when the sugar interests were lobbying Congress to do something about Cuba. They wanted to find a way to get direct American control in Cuba so as to have an easier opportunity to control the sugar industry there. They did. They helped get us into the Spanish-American War. There is no evidence, as I think we all know, there is no evidence that the Spanish blew up the USS Maine.
Sure they did.
In fact, the President of the United States was himself very skeptical of the reports that the reports were that it was due to faulty equipment on the ship. Later, the suggestion was that it was probably cordite, which is something that was used in gunpowder at that time, that exploded, spontaneous combustion. Then, of course, William Randolph Hearst and a number of powerful lobbyists were able to convince Congress, or a large amount of a percentage of Congress, that no, it was the Spaniards who blew up the USS Maine in order to send the United States a message to stay out of Cuba. Now, an argument could have been made that it was the Cuban rebels themselves who blew up the Maine in order to draw the United States into the conflict that was already raging there. We'll never know, because all of the reports are flawed. Hysteria reigns supreme. And yeah, William Randolph Hearst and the sugar interests and a few other groups led us into a war that we probably didn't have to go into. Indeed, we definitely didn't have to go into. We have this today, we have a situation where, and our speaker will know this, Senator Paul Simon, when he decided that he was not going to run for another Senate term, gave as his reason, to some newspaper reporters at least, that he was spending so much time And it's a 6-year term, folks. It's not 2 years like a congressman. He was spending better than half of his time as an entrenched incumbent congressman raising funds for the next election.
Well, we need to give some more time to the other speakers, Pat. Your time's run out.
Okay, my time has run out?
Yes.
Okay.
Very well,
one last thing. Don't ban newspaper advertising for campaigns. You're going to drive me into having to find an honest way to make a living. I'm unsuited for the clergy.
All right.
I can't be a lawyer, and if I don't get off right now, I'll be a dead man.
All right.
They blow up our ship, and we shouldn't do anything about it. Yeah.
Hey, Tim, can you reset
get them
the clock?
Spam.
I already have.
Okay, great. And then occasionally turn and let me see it.
I'll just go ahead and start it. Okay, when you're ready?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
I would urge, for the first time in a long time, I find myself virtually in almost total agreement with most of the comments that were made here tonight. And I hope that some people will begin to see that we're on the same page. I would approach this, I think the speaker gave an excellent presentation tonight of what needs to be done. The first thing I would point out is that I think low voter turnout is a symptom of the media coverage, basic education as far as voters go. People care about issues that affect their lives. If they don't know that politicians are involved in affecting their lives, they're not going to try to do much about it. Project Censored out of Sonoma State, this is the 2011 edition, they run a media program that describes how the media in America maintains people in a certain state of belief on certain issues. And for the last 10 years or so, they've been talking about a truth emergency in America, an issue with low voter turnout, uninformed voters. Everybody is decrying the uninformed voter. Well, Rick Schenken wrote a book called Just How Stupid Are We? And it says, Facing the Truth About the American Voter. It describes in here, there's instances where Jay Leno makes a lot of fun of the person on the street. They'll go out with a microphone and ask people questions. And some people don't know that the state of Israel is not located between Texas and Arkansas. Other people don't know that, you know, they'll ask, what day of the week do you think Good Friday falls on? And people can't answer that one. In certain categories of information that should be common knowledge, Americans are really, really uninformed, and that's part of the problem. I would suggest everybody start with a copy of the current censored news book or log on to their Project Censored website, projectcensored.org. They got the last 20 years of archive, all the stories, the top 25 blacked out stories of the year that would change America overnight if they were covered rather than blacked out. The Tribune just ran a classic Orwellian headline, right, 2-3 days ago. It says class warfare happening again. Like, you know, the Democrats are involved in class warfare against rich people, asking them to pay their fair share. Nothing could be more, well, as Warren Buffett said, class warfare is happening in America, and my class is winning. The billionaires have been winning. America, American middle class has been solidly under attack since the 70s, but it picked up in 1980. Tom Hartman just published an article on Common Dreams yesterday. It says Reaganomics is a all-out cancer on America. The idea that you shovel money to rich people and it will improve things. We teach seventh graders. The seventh graders that I coach, we teach them, in order to solve any problem, you must first correctly identify the problem and then correctly identify the solutions. We have big money in motion in America, huge money. Our Congress is totally bought and sold, owned by billionaires.
I see my time is just about up. I'll finish this thought in 10 seconds. We get what we pay for, and if the future of our country means anything to us, then we have to spend some of our time and money helping our friends and neighbors learn what's going on. Again, buy a copy of this book, Barnes & Noble, Amazon, okay. And start there. Thank you.
All right.
All right, very quickly, I don't have much to say, but once again, let's thank our speaker, David, for coming out here. Yeah, you think they could blow up our ship and we shouldn't do anything about it. I say go out and get them and kill them.
Right.
Yeah, what kind of American are you?
Probably an American who would have wanted to look at the evidence first.
Oh, we've never gone to war before without
any reason. In fact, President McKinley tried to look at the evidence, but he was told by the congressman he'd be impeached if he didn't.
Okay. You guys, all right, I just have one thing to say here. You guys want to start mucking around with the electoral process. You better be careful. You may get more than you wish for. I think there's some stories to that effect. In the independent voters of Illinois, you want to flatten out the electoral process here. You want to make it all horizontal and no vertical elements or a corruptive outside influence. However, in the independent voters of Illinois, we get the applications, we sit down, and then we review these, and the first thing you look for, a lot of people don't know this, is does in fact that individual have a viable campaign? And 99% of the time, many candidates we were not going to endorse a candidate who cannot put together a viable campaign. And we've had them speak here at the college. I know this. They don't have the basic fabric for putting together a campaign, and yet they seek higher office. And that's what I mean. You want to give money and power and influence to these people on what qualifications? Certainly there is a thing where there's an undue purchase of positions and things of this nature. However, there is a process that, I mean, you did give figures there that there is an enormous cost to these campaigns. There are people expecting to be elected to public office who don't have the self-discipline or something they're lacking that say, yes, you've got to put together some sort of organization in order to get yourself elected. That's going to take money. Now, whether that comes from the public or a private source, I don't know. But it's a little test that we have. And I certainly know this issue of getting the signatures. It's the same thing. It's a hurdle. Now, it can be used by one political party to keep candidates off the ballot. I'm certainly aware of that. You have to get 10,000 signatures in a 30-day period starting at January 1 to January 31st. That's been one party's been doing that for years to keep the people off the ballot. On the other hand, if you can't get together an organization to collect the minimal threshold in order to qualify, you're wasting your time to the voters. And the other thing we're not going to get qualified people serving for office. That's the bottom line. Because you're going to get nutcases like the girl I was telling you about, who thinks that God is angry with the state of Illinois and manifested itself by giving us tornadoes. All right, thank you.
All right, whose pen is this?
You guys want everything.
All right, does anybody else wish to give a rebuttal speech?
Oh, one last thing. The guy next week is speaking somewhat on the same. He's got a lot of articles on his website. Go to the...
That's Move to Amend, right?
Yeah, and you can link to his website. He's got all kinds of articles you might want to look at.
All right. Is there anybody else who wishes to give a rebuttal speech? Tim, have you haven't given a rebuttal speech yet?
No.
Come on down.
All right.
Well,
let me
we'll
to,
go over
time
a little bit.
They let us do it?
That's good. Yeah,
oh,
I'll tell you very brief.
Because
I'll tell you.
Stuff's running.
Time's up. Hey, take it easy, Joe.
You know, for once, I have to agree with Charlie on this issue. There is a certain amount of public charisma and organization that comes into running for political office. Whether you be a local official or running for national office, one of the primary skills of being a politician is learning how to speak in public, motivate your constituency, take care of people who want to move. Move in the way of their constituency, take care of things, and for one reason, money does have a little bit of a play in that. Now, I'm not for, we'd like to reform things, but there is a little bit of something that says, hey, this guy can run for political office if he can put together a voluntary organization. I'll give you a real good example of somebody who I worked with just a very little bit to help run for political office. It was a gal by the name of Jill Morgenthaler, who basically ran a congressional campaign against Dave Roskam a few years ago. She was a very good, highly motivated public speaker. She did have a committed core of volunteers, but she wasn't able to raise the funds necessary to go against the incumbent. In that case, there may have been some case for political reform or for more money to be brought in. But the point of the matter is, she did put together an organization. She did get a group of motivated volunteers. And in a lot of cases, Charlie is absolutely right. You do need to have that ability before you get into public office. Thank you.
All right. All right. All right. Would anybody else like to give a rebuttal speech? No? All right. Well, we're running out of time anyways. All right. Well, first of all, I'd like to thank our speaker once again, David Melton, for giving a very informative and enlightening speech and very educational here at the College of Complexes. Second, I'd just like to say briefly, by the way, are you timing me, Tim?
Not well now.
Okay. All right. I have been accused of talking long, but that's a common habit here. All right. First of all, I think campaign finance is a very serious issue. It's kind of, as our speaker said, it's kind of what you might call almost a meta issue. It's an issue that affects all the other issues, because if you have, it's central to a functioning democracy. You know, whatever laws you want to get passed, whether it's an environmental law, or whether you want a new government program, or whatever, it depends on your ability to have a voice in the government, to be able to influence the government. Now the idea of democracy, and I would hope that most of us still believe in democracy, I do, but the idea of democracy is government by the people. But if you've got just a very small number of rich people who finance all the politicians, or most of the politicians, doesn't even have to be all, then and that pretty much determines, if that just determines the agenda of the politicians, and the people have no choice then to vote for Tweedledum or Tweedledee, then what you don't have then is not really a democracy at all anymore. It's an oligarchy ruled by an elite. Now I would think that is an issue that would concern everybody. You know, whether you call yourself a conservative or a liberal, whether you call yourself a libertarian or an anarchist, or whether you're on the left or the right, whatever you call yourself. And at this point, I felt that this was an especially good presentation tonight. It was very informative, and I learned a lot from it. I would give a little bit of advice to our speaker. First of all, I would say that I don't think it's a good idea to call the opponents of your agenda right wing. Because now, if you're trying to run a non-partisan organization, the terms right-wing and Republican have become almost synonyms now. So you're kind of, when you use that term, you're tipping your hand a little bit. And plus, the terms left and right have become so vague as to be almost that they've almost lost their meaning. And it would be more accurate to say that the people who, to just say the opponents of campaign finance reform, or the people who are in favor of unlimited contributions, or just to describe them as, or, you know, the people who are on the side of the rich, just call them what they are, okay? Because there are rich contributors to the Democratic Party as well as to the Republican Party, which comes to my second point. I don't think, if you're representing an organization that's supposed to be nonpartisan, it's not a good idea to advocate the people who vote Democratic. You might sincerely believe and have a good argument for the idea that the Democrats are a better choice than the Republicans, or the less bad choice. But it's not a good idea to come out and say that in a public forum on videotape. Because the truth of the matter is that the Democrats are nearly as corrupt and pro-corporate as the Republicans. The Democrats get most of their money from rich contributors too, just like the Republicans do. It just may be that their contributors are more in favor of gay rights.
I didn't hear him on one side.
Now,
where was he so one-sided?
Okay, now,
I didn't hear
now,
that.
The second thing I would like to say is I would make a distinction. How am I doing on time, Tim?
3 minutes, 35 seconds.
All right.
Okay, all right, now, I'm going to sum up real quick. Gary, you raised a question, I don't know if Gary's still here. But Gary raised an interesting question about democracy and about how you get the apathy. How do you get people interested to get out and vote? Well, I'm a member of an organization called Chicago Votes. And we're having a meeting tomorrow, as I mentioned at the beginning. And our goal is to get people registered to vote. And it's a statistical fact that if people are registered, they are more likely to vote than if they are not. So again, I want to just thank our speaker. And now it's your turn to give a speech.
I didn't hear any bias in his presentation, Don.
Oh, okay.
Thank you for all those comments.
Hear that.
And you're right. If I said something that indicated that as an organization we support one party or another, that was incorrect. I think I was responding to a question there about my personal beliefs, which are different than the organizational beliefs. But I agree with you actually that this is not a partisan issue. This is a bipartisan issue. Republicans should be on board with this as much as the Democrats. This is a bipartisan issue. I don't need to make that argument in depth and bore you here with a lot of details. Look at the Lessig books. He makes this argument at great length to show this should be a bipartisan issue because this is a threat to both Republicans and Democrats. So I agree with that point and I accept that criticism. If I misled anybody, that was inadvertent. Let me just quickly respond to some of the points. I may have missed a few because I was a little slow in starting to take notes, but let me make about 8 points. I'll try and make them relatively quick. So first, with respect to those people who talked about economic fairness, I agree 100% with those people, at least personally speaking. My organization is not that involved with these issues, but in order for us to effectively address those economic issues, we are living in a new gilded age. We do need legislation at the federal level to deal with those issues of social fairness. But we're never going to get it in a system where the politicians are only interested in the interests of those few rich contributors. So before we can even attempt to address or hope to have Congress address those issues, I think we need campaign finance reform as a preliminary step to try and address those more difficult economic fairness issues. With respect to the person who talked about trying to regulate supply, I agree with you that essentially we're trying to regulate supply in the current system and it's not working. I don't agree that the right way to approach it is to try and regulate demand because I think that raises fundamental First Amendment questions and takes us away from our core value that the right way to reach the truth is through debate. That's essentially the heart of the First Amendment. And if you start limiting demand, you're making it too easy for incumbents to embed themselves in power. Essentially, regulating demand is what dictators do. And I think the proof of the pudding there is what's happened with super PACs. It's one thing to say you can limit what candidates can spend, but all you're going to do is force that money out into the super PAC arena, where then are you going to say to people, you cannot run commercials expressing your own views about candidates? You're not a candidate, not affiliated with a candidate? I don't think so. I think that's too much of an infringement on people's First Amendment rights. That's a legitimate argument. So I don't think you can regulate demand, and the way to do this is to have the public pay for the democracy that it wants and that it deserves. Someone raised a question about if term limits are such a bad system, why do we get so many mediocre incumbents reelected? And I would say the short answer to that is two things. More mediocre candidate opponents, and dumb voters. And I don't know what the solutions are for the second one, but I think that's that would be the key to solving that problem. We also had comments about the pure democracy system and going to a pure democracy system, eliminating the representative aspect altogether. So this would contemplate that basically each of us, as a voter, would have to do what Congress people now do, educate themselves about bills, decide what the right decision is on many thousands of issues, and then vote on them. The problem with that is we'd spend all our time governing ourselves, and we would lose a lot of the benefits that we've gotten through specialization. Basically, specialization, in my view, is what's occurred over the past several centuries and has allowed us as societies to accumulate more wealth by allowing people to specialize and be more efficient. We've created more overall social wealth. That's a good thing. If you say we're going to go to a pure democratic government, you're going to get a lot of wasted time and effort that's going to detract from our economic competitiveness and from our overall social wealth. So I don't think it's a good idea. I think the founders were right in creating representative democracy. I agree with you that at the time it was created, it was a pretty aristocratic system. But I think over the last 200 years, we've made a lot of changes that have improved it. And I think those changes can continue and that we should continue to make them. As to those who referred to campaign contributions as legalized bribery, at certain levels, I do not disagree with that. And I think we are at those levels in some cases in our current system. As for the notion that politicians and rich people, I would assume as well, are simply seeking love.
No, not love.
Adulation or whatever you want to call it. I would simply say, I would urge you to rewatch Citizen Kane. I can't disagree with that. Redistricting. I did not mean to imply that the Democratic map was any more unfair than the Republican maps in the past. Certainly, it's not. I would never argue that. What I'm saying is, it's kind of a dumb system to allow the foxes to guard the hen house on redistricting, and we should change that aspect of the system for both parties so that at least we get a slightly better result going forward. But I don't think redistricting is the answer to solve this more fundamental problem of campaign finance reform. I can't read my note on that one. My final one deals with the question of whether we should go to Marxism as a solution to this problem. And I would say on that, if it is inevitable that money will rule in any system, regardless of what system you have, then let's at least adopt a system that makes it more difficult for people to influence and buy our politicians. If money's going to rule anyway, let so be it. But at least let's try and improve on that situation. You know, at the end of the 19th century, when Darwinism was in vogue and social Darwinism was in vogue, a lot of people said, there's nothing we can do to improve the situation. Rich people simply are control things because it's simply survival of the fittest. That's the way the world worked. There's nothing we can do to change that. Well, the progressive movement showed we could do something to change that. And we've known this for a long, long time. In fact, if you want to look in the Bible, you will see that as long as 2,000 years ago, some people have rejected that fatalism and said, yes, while everyone has to provide for themselves and satisfy their own needs, to the extent that people can gather or amass more than that, they also have responsibilities to other members of societies. And we are ultimately all our brothers and sisters' keepers. So that would be my solution to the let the survival of the fittest go on. And finally, with respect to revolution versus evolution, that's an interesting topic. I'd be happy to come back and talk on that. Yeah. But basically, I think that history has shown that, in general, evolution is a superior system to revolution because when you get revolution, you throw out the baby with the bathwater and you make a lot of mistakes that weren't made during the first time that you have to learn from. So, that completes my comments. I thank you all for your comments.
Very good. Very good. Very good.